to serve as Prime Minister of the United Kingdom is the greatest honour. Even her harshest critics must recognise her integrity, her commitment to public service, her dedication to this country. And those are qualities that none of us should ever take for granted. Boris Johnson is elected.
He's been elected by less than 100,000 people.
Boris is good. He's going to do a good job.
Now the reality of leadership demonstrated by action.
We will do a new deal, a better deal.
He entirely underestimates the situation.
I am today building a great team of men and women.
It's not so much of a reshuffle as a summer's day massacre.
Never mind the backstop, the buck stops here. I say, do not underestimate this country.
Prime Minister Johnson and team vote leave, take back control.
Joined now by Sonia Sodha of The Observer, Craig Oliver, former Director of Communications for David Cameron, the political editor of The Sun, Tom Newton Dunn, and Camilla Tominey, the associate editor at The Telegraph. No judgment. Who saw this coming? I don't mean the premiership, I mean the slashings and the shuffles.
I think we all saw that there was going to be what's been described online as a massacre of the current cabinet and a real change around, because having had a mantra of nothing has changed for the last 3 years, everything has had to change in order for Boris Johnson to carry out this vision of a Brexit delivered do or die by October the 31st.
I don't think anybody saw Penny Morden leaving the government. I think that is a genuine shock today. It feels to me like a real death or glory cabinet, an attempt to basically gather around him people who truly believe. That's Dominic Cummings all over.
This is do or die enacted.
Yeah, I think it's death or glory. I think Dominic Cummings is very much of the view there's no point in having people on board who don't truly believe. It's better to have a team around you that's focused exactly on what you want to do. And as a result, they've rolled the dice very hard tonight.
I mean, I have to hold up my hands and say I didn't quite see this coming. I expected Boris Johnson to, even if he didn't tap to the sort of more conciliatory in terms of his rhetoric, to maybe make a bit more of an effort to build a broad church cabinet. Because he's got such a slim working majority in Parliament. It's only two, potentially going to go down to one next week after the by-election next week. And so it's going to be very, very tight for him in Parliament. But I think what Boris Johnson has done has projected forwards, seen that there's going to be a massive parliamentary showdown at some point, and work backwards from that. So it feels very much like a cabinet that's been pulled together, a vote leave cabinet, the no deal cabinet, gearing up for a general election. It feels like he's given up on the idea of building unity within his party and within Parliament.
It feels like the last 3 years that the whole May episode has just been erased. I mean, he could have picked up from the referendum result to this point without any of what we've just seen.
Well, and you know, there's an awful lot of people way back in 2016 saying precisely that should have happened. So the great criticism of Theresa May is she tried to take the whole party with her. She ended up with nobody. So Boris Johnson has gone at it with his own tribe and a very particular loyal tribe. I mean, quite frankly, actually none of us really saw the scale of this coming. It's quite extraordinarily brutal. But the signs were all there. I mean, Boris Johnson has been saying do or die for 8 weeks. Mm. We all thought that was just bluster. Turns out it was totally true.
But also, isn't it worth pointing out that while he has appointed four of them five top jobs to Brexiteers, actually, if you look through the whole numbers, it's half leave, half remain, this cabinet. It's not a, you know, it's not a bonfire of remainers.
I've just tied mine up.
There's a half remain contingency in there.
15
a lot
remainers,
of them are believers.
13 leavers, so it's almost exactly.
But 100% people prepared to say that there should be a hard Brexit.
But he had said that in the leadership
campaign. No, sure, but don't pretend that there isn't a split, that it has
one
direction.
No, I'm not pretending, because I'm saying that some of the remainers are people who are believers. Mm. They are people who have said, I voted remain, but I accept the democratic will of the people, and I want Brexit to be delivered. They've also had to sign up to this cabinet pledge, which he had mooted at the leadership during leadership hustings, of saying, look, I don't want anyone in there that's going to agitate and start saying that we need to take no deal off the table.
But
Amber Rudd's still there, and she seems to have been converted.
Well, are we now 3 months away from an election. Does everyone agree that that's what it's about? Was a lie.
I think this has the makings of not just a cabinet built to fight a general election, but a cabinet who's going to start fighting that general election tomorrow. They're going to campaign ruthlessly, talk about no deal a lot, talk about all the Herculean efforts they're doing, only to be potentially frustrated by those terrible MPs behind us, in which case we then go to the country.
And how then does he get the country? I mean, what happens to the Scottish Tories? What happens to the Lib Dems that he needs to win over? Yes, he gets the Brexit party this way, but...
That's the calculation.
I was going to say, this is a really interesting thing. Anybody who knows anything about Scottish politics knows that he's very toxic there. Liberal Conservative seats, very difficult for him to win. That means they've got to win over Midlands and North of England Labour Brexit seats. They tried it in 2017, didn't work. They would say that's because Theresa May was running the election campaign and Boris is different. It's going to be quite tricky. I suspect Dominic Cummings has done a lot of research already, and by the way, that was pretty smart, managing to keep him under wraps for this long. But it's probably done quite a lot of research and thinks he might be able to build that Brexit coalition and win.
But the polling does suggest that as leader, Boris Johnson was the only Conservative who could win over the Nigel Farage brigade. And we have to not forget that there was a period not that long ago where the likes of Anne Widdecombe was being given a standing ovation in a working man's club in Featherston near Pontefract. So there is clearly a hugely disaffected group of leavers, probably left-leaning, who might want to just vote for a Eurosceptic Prime Minister simply to see Brexit delivered.
The problem with that strategy, though, is, I mean, effectively what Boris Johnson is doing is tacking right, and that's very clear from who he surrounded himself with, the top jobs in the government. And it's clear that he's making that move, but at the same time, he's got voters that the Tories risk shedding to the Liberal Democrats.
Well, does he then deselect the people that have, been in sort of his mind traitors and bring in Brexit Party PPCs?
Would be a bit of a radical solution. I mean, he can't on one hand suggest that he's honouring the democratic will of the people and then start kind of using Corbynist tactics to deselect Tory MPs. But I think they're very much going to position themselves, this government, as the party of Brexit against Labour's constructive ambiguity and the Liberal Democrats' pro-Remain stance.
There is another option, of course, which none of us talked about, which is a second referendum. Remember what Vote Leave did the first time? They think they can win referendums. Dominic Cummings has certainly proved pretty good at it to Sir Craig's sad demise. It wouldn't surprise me at all if they don't roll the dice and sign themselves up to possibly a suicidal general election with top slicing to the Lib Dems and to the Brexit Party, and think they can really
There is a problem with that. You win the referendum and you still only got a working majority of two, which defrays over time and means you may have to fight a general election anyway.
Whenever we sit here, we hear a little bit of noises off. Today it was quite profound, actually, the sort of protest, the pictures that we've seen, even watching Grant Shapps trying to get in. I don't know if we can bring you some of the pictures from here, the flares, the protests, you'll remember. I mean, that's quite a crowd, isn't it? Not to mention the protesters, the climate change protesters that were trying to stop Boris Johnson from getting to Downing Street. Would you be worried about any of this if you were... Yeah.
Well, there's no doubt about it. Boris Johnson is an incredibly divisive figure. And while he may have an appeal to voters that the Tories have been losing to the Brexit Party, I think that certainly doesn't go to the sort of wider electorate, particularly to swing voters who may be considering voting in other ways. And if you look at his approval ratings sort of going into Downing Street, they're actually lower than Theresa May's. So I think it is a real problem for Boris Johnson. Obviously, you know, it's a relatively small number of people who are out protesting on the streets today. But I think it's significant, but symbolises the fact that Boris Johnson is now a very divisive figure. He's not the same sort of character that he was back when he was running for Mayor of London.
We're looking at what happens next, what happens in October. What about the bigger question of whether politics is fundamentally shifting with characters like Dom Cummings coming in? Is this a whole circumnavigation of Whitehall, of the civil service?
We've spent 3 years saying, why hasn't somebody formed a new centre party? And the reason for that is actually, I think a lot of strategists have looked at politics and think splitting the difference isn't really working. People are dividing, they are moving apart. And I think that when people have done analysis, they think actually the Conservative Party probably does have to choose Brexit. The Labour Party still isn't choosing Remain, and look at where it is in the polls. So I think that that's sort of, a lot of strategists are looking at the reality of British politics and thinking it's only by pushing to the extremes that we actually can see a route
through. But does that mean that the civil service is now no longer central to British government and the way we are governed?
The civil service has been so beaten black and blue over the last 3 years, it's going to be pretty compliant now. The last thing the civil service really wants is yet another punch up with a prime minister load of cabinet ministers. I don't see them causing huge amounts of trouble. I do think that this is inevitably ending up in a poll nationwide with people having to cast a vote one way or other before the end of the year. Brexit before a second referendum, it's slightly chicken and the egg. You might need one to do the other, to live Brexit to win a majority. But I think the civil service will be thinking, right, we have a few days or weeks left of this government before we may get Jeremy Corbyn or some other completely strange
compunction. Do you think they're already thinking that it won't last?
Well, I would be if I was them. Boris Johnson will be down to a majority of two next week, one or two defections to the Lib Dems, and it really is all over because they'll lose the confidence vote before he even gets to October.
Also, with that in mind, the speech today, he's trying to recalibrate what he, I think, perceives as a misunderstanding about where he is politically. Because Brexit has been described as a right-wing construct, he is aligned with right-wing thinking, when actually, I'm sure Craig will agree, he's not particularly. I mean, some people describe him as one of the most left-wing Conservative prime ministers we might have. So it's that ability, has he got that ability to appeal to people who both want Brexit to be delivered, but also to follow some sort of domestic social justice agenda? That's the big struggle he has, because the protesters out on the streets today are making out as if he's, you know, an extreme right winger in all of his views, and that's simply not true.
Well, we don't know.
You know what he thinks about tax, and you know what he thinks about the death penalty back in
2011. He's got some real right wingers around him now in the top jobs. That doesn't send a signal that he's going to be liberal on domestic policy. I think if you look at Dominic Raab or
Amber Rudd isn't a right winger. There are lots
she's
of people
not in one
of
the top jobs
cabinet.
Though.
Well, she retains, I think, DWP as far as left wing voters will be concerned, will think that's a really, really important job. She's in charge of benefits.
What did you make of the language today? I mean, that moment, you know, on the steps of Downing Street, you know, we're geared up to expect the where there is division, you know, we will have discord and unity. He got straight on with Brexit, didn't he? I mean, it was,
and
was something
batted
quite
Theresa May aside immediately.
Right.
There wasn't even any attempt to say that the last 3 years that there was anything of worth in that, really, just batted it aside. I think that they've worked out, look, the chances are we're probably going to have to face some kind of vote very soon, so we might as well double down and go for it.
He was campaigning today,
and I think he's learned a lot from Steve Bannon and from Donald Trump. Constantly campaigning, seeing people protesting
is
yes, and I think not seeing people protesting is not necessarily a bad thing. You use that to rile your base. You use that to say, look, there is division. Be on our side. You're on one side.
So when
he
talks about energy, that's how you get energy. You constantly sound as if you're street fighting.
Absolutely, and a little bit of street protests where people are trying to destroy your dream of Brexit is no bad thing to future waves of the country. I would, however, just caveat all this to say this is a very Brexity cabinet, no doubt about it, but it is not a hard-line Brexit. The ERG, Jacob Rees-Mogg, has just squeezed in as leader of the Commons. The ERG have no representation at all apart from Jacob, who's a reasonably moderate chairman. Steve Baker hasn't got in at all.
How is it not hard-line to say that you have to be a member? A member of the cabinet unless you say you're prepared
different
to be a
gradations.
Manager.
These aren't my definitions, these are other people's
line.
But my point is a slightly different one, which is there is still a shot at a deal here. It may be a very narrow one, it's a tiny little landing strip. You could probably get a white right on it.
What do you think Europe's saying to this now? Do you think they're saying he's serious?
Well, there's a key phrase that Boris made in his speech that not many people picked up, and I had to read it twice. We talked about, and we're not going to be doing any business with that backstop. Not any backstop, just that backstop. That, to me, I think we heard in Brussels, maybe he will have a backstop after all. We just need to modify.
And it is definitely true that you can see that Ireland is getting very nervous at the moment. And those signals are being sent into Europe. And do they try and move? Do they try and give a lick of paint to Theresa May's deal? present it as something else. I think it's very unlikely that would get through, and Boris Johnson's worked that out.
That's but the still internal possible. Battle going on, though, isn't it? Because you have Geoffrey Crock still as Attorney General trying to push through with the idea of a kind of completely redrafted but similar withdrawal agreement versus the ERG hardline approach of tear it up, it's dead.
I'm so sorry, guys, we've run out of time.
Thank you all very much indeed. Kirsty is back tomorrow from all of us here. Good night. Thanks for watching. Bye-bye.